Good afternoon. Today's lecture is about the Cold War. And we have to start with what Europe looked like at the end of World War II to really understand where the Cold War comes from. To put it simply, after World War II, Europe is destroyed. So much fighting happened in both Eastern and Western Europe that the devastation is worse than it was in World War I. This is due to new technologies. This is due to new forms of warfare. This is due to larger armies than before even. So there are some serious concerns that there's going to be another economic collapse. After World War I, there was an economic collapse, and people are really thinking, okay, it's going to happen again. The United States comes up with a plan called the Marshall Plan, and it's named for George C. Marshall, who was the United States Secretary of State at the end of World War II. And this was an economic rescue plan. The United States was going to give countries in Europe something around $12 billion. And this $12 billion was going to be used to rebuild the economies and the infrastructure and even the buildings of European countries. Now, if you were to scale that up to today, that's about $130 to $135 billion. That's a lot of money. It was offered to any country in Europe, and a lot of the Western European countries took it, but the Soviet Union refused. And when the Soviet Union refused, that meant that all of the Eastern European countries that were being drawn in by the Soviet Union were forced to refuse it as well. There were a couple of parts to this plan. Number one, it was going to be used to reduce trade barriers, to reduce tariffs. It was going to be used to create a modern industrial sector, and it was going to be used just for everyday rebuilding as well. And ideally, the rebuilding was going to be done by American firms so that America got back some of this money. Now, what does this Marshall Plan do? It rebuilds Europe and it creates something called the European Economic Community. And we know the European Economic Community better today as the European Union. Also, at the end of World War II, we have the creation of the United Nations. You could almost call this League of Nations 2.0, because a lot of the United Nations is based on the ideas and the concepts of the old United Nations. Now, the UN is supposed to be a place where all countries can get together. This is an idea, or a forum, if you will, where problems can be worked out. Agreements can be made and problem solved. The United Nations has done a very good job of giving countries a place where they can speak, but it has not stopped all wars. There have been some wars, although nothing as big as the world wars were, and it also didn't stop wars of ideas, and that's where the Cold War comes in. The Cold War was primarily a war of ideas, capitalism versus communism. Now, where does the Cold War actually come from? And I usually try to break it down to these three things. There's post-war control. The Potsdam Conference in April of 1945 really drew a divide between Eastern Europe and Western Europe. I think that in April of 1945, when the United States, Great Britain, and the Soviet Union all sat down to talk in that final conference, the difference between the two had gotten so big that neither side trusted each other at all. The Soviets want to expand communism, and the Soviets are going to take control of most of Eastern Europe, and the Western world is basically going to give up and say there's no way that democracy is going to overcome communism everywhere. Then we have something called the Truman Doctrine of 1947. This is a statement made by the president, Harry S. Truman. And I have the most important part of it there. It says the U.S. must support free peoples around the world who are resisting efforts by outsiders or armed minorities to overthrow their governments. This means that the United States in 1947 is pledging to stop the spread of communism everywhere, whether that be in countries such as Greece, countries such as Germany, countries such as Argentina, or even your backyard. The United States is going to attempt to stop the spread of communism anywhere it happens. And last but not least, our good old friend alliances. You would think after World War I, we learned alliances have problems. You would think after World War II, we would have learned alliances have problems, but guess what? We don't learn. There is a series of Western alliances. There's NATO, North Atlantic Treaty Organization. That covers the United States, Canada, France, Western Europe, Great Britain, you name it. CETO, which is the Southeast Atlantic Treaty Organization. CETO covered South Vietnam, Singapore, South Korea, and all of those places. Then you've got ANZUS, Australia, New Zealand, United States. That one's pretty self-explanatory. And then you have OAS, which was the Organization of American States. And what the OAS covered was countries in both North and South America. So all these Western alliances were working together to promote democracy and promote capitalism. There was one communist alliance, that was the Warsaw Pact. And the Warsaw Pact included places in Eastern Europe, along with the Soviet Union. Eventually Cuba will join also. Even though China is communist, it does not join the Warsaw Pact. China and the Soviet Union did not trust each other. And that's primarily because of how communism developed in the two countries. Not to go too far into it, but in the Soviet Union, the communist revolution was mostly a middle class phenomena. While in China, the communist revolution was entirely a peasant, a lower class revolution. And because the two communist parties got their source of power from different groups of people, they didn't trust each other. Now, what are the Cold War battlefields? If it's a war, there has to be fighting, right? Yes and no. Primarily, the Cold War is a war of ideas. One of the ideas is this fight over third world countries. And these third world countries, they're not truly free, but they're not communist. They're kind of stuck in the middle. In a lot of ways, these third world countries are looking for a way that they can develop. Today we think of a third world country as very poor, very undeveloped, if you will. But originally, these were going to be countries that had a lot of natural resources. They usually had unsteady governments. In many cases, these are going to be places that were former colonies, or they're places that are trying to develop economically, but they're having problems. So the Western countries, specifically places like the United States, would offer these third world nations something. And then very often those third world nations would look at the Soviet Union and say, well, here's what the United States is going to give me. What can you give me? A great example of that is the former country known as the Congo in Africa. The Congo basically had a dictator in charge, but it was a dictator who pretended to be democratic. And so the United States would help the Congo all the time. But then that same leader who was getting all these weapons and all this money from the United States would turn and get stuff from the Soviet Union as well, because it was the way that this dictator thought he could maintain control of his country. We also have this idea of nuclear weapons. It's an idea, it's a technology, it's kind of confusing, I know. But nuclear weapons, the United States is the only country that has ever used nuclear weapons against an enemy. And we did it twice in 1945 against Japan. So for a brief amount of time, the United States has a monopoly on nuclear weapons. The only other country that knew that the United States was developing nuclear weapons was the United Kingdom. The United States hid this information from everybody else. After World War II ended, it was later found out that Nazi Germany was developing nuclear capabilities, but they were way, way behind the United States. When the first nuclear bomb and the second nuclear bomb are used, it shocks the world, and the Soviet Union has to play catch-up. They're going to employ spies, such as Julius and Ethel Rosenberg, to steal secrets from the United States government. And by 1949, the Soviet Union is going to test its first nuclear weapon as well. So by 1950, there are two nuclear capable countries. By the time we get to 1970, two has become six. Great Britain, France, the United States, Soviet Union, China, and India are all nuclear countries. Now, of those six, you might say, why India? Well, it's actually because India was one of those third world countries, and India was worried about having to protect itself from both the East and West. Today, in 2021, to that list of six nations, we have now added Israel, North Korea, and Pakistan. Also, there's one country who tested a nuclear weapon and then voluntarily gave up its entire program, and that was South Africa. South Africa and Israel worked together on their nuclear program throughout the 1970s and into the 1980s. And when those two countries successfully tested their nuclear weapon, South Africa gave it all to the United Nations, while Israel kept it all secret. And just recently, in the past 5 years, finally admitted to having nuclear weapons, even though everybody knew they already did. So nuclear weapons are going to become this arms race. There's fission bombs, there's fusion bombs, there's hydrogen bombs, there's neutron bombs. And the most powerful bomb ever created was a cobalt salt bomb. And the largest bomb ever actually tested was the Tsar Bomba by the Soviet Union on October 30th, 1961. It was a bomb with such a theoretically high yield or high destructive power that it was not actually tested at full power. The United States, through the Cold War, is going to initially come up with this idea called mutual assured destruction, or MAD. And this was really, really championed by President Dwight D. Eisenhower. Long story short, if you launch a nuclear weapon at us, we will launch a nuclear weapon at you, no questions asked. And the United States was ready to destroy the world. Soviet Union was too, but the United States was the one that put this policy into place first. So there were real fears that the world was going to be destroyed in a nuclear war. I went to elementary school at the end of the Cold War, and I can still remember duck and cover tests or duck and cover drills where we were expected to get underneath our desk in kindergarten and first grade and have that desk somehow keep us safe from a nuclear weapon. So the Cold War was not that long ago, and there were serious fears that nuclear weapons would kill everybody. Another Cold War battlefield is space. In 1957, the Soviet Union launches the first satellite, and it was about the size of a Volkswagen wagon, or if you've seen those, a Volkswagen wagon, and it circled the Earth for a couple of weeks, and it let out this audible ping. If you turned your radio to a certain station, you could hear this Sputnik go ping, ping, ping as it was sending out a radio signal. This scared the United States horribly. A future president, then Senator Lyndon Baines Johnson, LBJ, goes on record and said that he refused to sleep under the light of a damned communist moon. The Soviet Union for Sputnik 2, which is launched in 1958, I think it is, they sent a dog to space. It's a dog named Laika. And Laika was a dog. It was a stray dog. She was found on the streets of Moscow. And they trained her to eat while in space. And they stress test her and all this other stuff. And that's a picture of Laika before she goes off into space. And it's not a happy ending. I'll let you look up information on Laika yourself. But I'll just say it's not a happy ending. In response to the Soviet Union sending dogs into space, the United States sends monkeys. And these monkeys survive and come back. And one of the monkeys, believe it or not, is actually preserved and stuffed and located in the Smithsonian Institute Museum in Washington, D.C. Then, after animal testing is done, it comes time to put humans in space. The Soviet Union begins a cosmonaut training program, and the United States begins an astronaut training program. And there's this race to get the first person into space. And on April 12, 1961, the Soviet Union launches Commander Yuri Gagarin into space. Yuri Gagarin becomes the first person to orbit the Earth. And the United States responds on February 20th, 1962, by launching John Glenn into space, who will eventually become a senator from Ohio. The next step in this space race is to go to the moon, and John F. Kennedy in 1961 promises to place an American on the moon by the end of the decade. Now, ironically, I had a chance to speak to the NASA historian about this, and the United States government was purposely vague on whether the end of the century, or the end of the decade, I mean, meant 1969 or 1970, simply because they wanted to hedge their bets. NASA wasn't sure they could actually pull it off by 1969, and if they hadn't, they knew they could do it by 1970, and technically that would have been within a decade. So we get three very, very expensive programs that are created by the U.S. government. You've got the Mercury program, which was to work on getting a rocket out of the atmosphere. The Gemini program, which was focused on being able to have people orbit the Earth. And then the Apollo mission, which was actually going to take people to the moon and back. The Apollo missions by themselves cost $25 billion in 1960s money, which was somewhere around 10 to 15% of the entire United States government budget. To put that in perspective, today NASA is less than 2% of the US budget. And of course, Apollo 11 is going to land on the moon July 20th, 1969, with Buzz Aldrin, with Neil Armstrong, and then the person who is very often forgotten because he never got to set foot on the moon is Michael Collins, who had to stay in Apollo 11 and monitor what Buzz Aldrin and Neil Armstrong were doing down on the face of the moon. Now, I said there were a couple of wars, and the Korean War was one of those two wars, and this is a result of the Cold War getting started. After World War II is over, the peninsula of Korea is divided in half. Before World War II, Korea was a Japanese colony, and after World War II, of course, it couldn't be given back to Japan. So it was decided that the Soviet Army would occupy the northern half of the Korean Peninsula. The U.S. Army would occupy the southern half of the Korean Peninsula. And the goal was to reunite the two parts of the country after elections could happen. Well, both the United States and the Soviet Union, they've got different ideas for what's going to happen in Korea. So the Soviet Union is going to find a communist sympathizer named Kim Il-sung, and Kim Il-sung is going to be nominated to be the leader of Korea. The United States is going to find a gentleman named Syngman Rhee to be their candidate for leader. And Syngman Rhee, even though he was supported by the United States, he was not in any way democratic. He was a dictator. Now, when it comes election time, the Soviet Union is going to say no to this election because they're afraid they're going to lose. And the reason they think they're going to lose is 2/3 of the population of Korea lives below or south of the 38th parallel. The United States is afraid they're going to lose because Kim Il-sung was more popular. So in the middle of this argument over whether the election should happen or not, Joseph Stalin, the leader of the Soviet Union, encourages and basically pokes and prods Kim Il-sung to attack the southern half of Korea to create this communist state, this communist country. Now, part of that was to give the Soviet Union another ally, but it was also to show China and Japan, hey, the Soviets are going to be a major player in Asian affairs. It also didn't help that shortly before this attack happens, the United States Secretary of State Dean Acheson goes on live TV and makes a speech saying that Korea is not important to the United States. And because this speech is given saying the United States is that Korea is not vital to the interests of the United States, the Soviet Union saw it as, hey, it's no big deal if we invade and attack and create this communist country. The attack takes everybody by surprise, and the United Nations Security Council is going to have a meeting to decide what to do. Conveniently, this meeting is done on a day that the Soviet representative to the UN is absent. And a vote is taken on June 27th, 1950 to help South Korea fight off this attack. This war is going to turn into a 3-year stalemate. And if you've ever seen the TV show MASH, MASH is not actually set during the Vietnam War. It's set during the Korean War. And a lot of people are surprised by that. So 3 long years of fighting, 3 years of stalemate. Neither side really gains much of an advantage. Initially, the North Korean army almost drives the U.S. off of the Korean Peninsula, but then there's a counterattack, and the United States Army fights to within 20 miles of the Chinese border. The Chinese enter the war, and the United States fights Chinese soldiers, and within a couple of months, it's all back to the 38th parallel. The Korean War is going to end in a peace treaty. Just kidding. No, it doesn't. Even today in 2021, there is no formal peace treaty between North and South Korea. There is no formal peace treaty between North Korea and the United States. It all ends in a ceasefire. On paper, technically, the Korean War is still going on today, and there have been points in time, especially in 1968 and 1969, where the fighting has flared back up and it looked like full-scale war was going to happen again. There are some other events of the Cold War that are very important. First of all, there's the Berlin Airlift of 1948. Now, you're going to see these two very colorful maps here, and just to explain what they are, after World War II, both the city of Berlin and Germany proper were divided into sectors. So you've got the Soviet portion of Germany, you've got the Great Britain section of Germany, you've got the French section of Germany here, you've got the American section of Germany. This little flag, then this little tan, that's technically part of Germany, but it was called the Saarland. And after World War II, it was decided to make the Saarland into an independent nation. Unfortunately, the people of the Saarland didn't want that, and they eventually vote to rejoin Germany. Over here, the country of Poland is created, and this part of former Germany is given to the new country of Poland. The bottom map, this is a map of the city of Berlin, and just like Germany itself was divided, Berlin was divided. So you've got the Eastern Soviet part, French part, British part, and American part. Eventually, in both Berlin and in Germany itself, Great Britain, France, and the United States combine their portions of Germany together, and they combine their portions of Berlin together. And that's where East Germany and West Germany were born, as well as East Berlin and West Berlin. Now, when we get to 1948, Joseph Stalin is going to order Berlin be blockaded. Since Berlin was in the middle of East Germany, it was very hard to get in and out. There were only a couple of roads that went to Berlin that could be used by the West. And in 1948, Stalin is going to order those roads closed. Well, when those roads are closed, the only way to get supplies into Berlin is through air. Now, you might ask, why was Joseph Stalin cutting off aid to the city of Berlin? It's because he wanted all of Berlin for East Germany. Well, when the Berlin airlift gets going, the United States is going to have airplanes coming into the airport in West Berlin day and night at all hours. And over 2.5 million tons of supplies are going to be shipped into Berlin by airplane over the next 10 months. It's over 1,500 tons of food per day and like 3,500 tons of fuel. Everything that the West Berliners needed to survive was brought in on U.S. cargo planes. An event that I think is very, very important to the Cold War and understanding how it develops is NSC 68. So make sure that you look at NSC 68. It's even more important than the Truman Doctrine was. The NSC 68 report was issued in 1950, and it established that the United States has to take the lead in communism, that the United States must stop communism no matter what, wherever it occurs. Doesn't matter how big or small the value of that place is, the United States is going to stop communism. This is going to lead to war in Vietnam. It's going to lead to proxy wars in Central America. It's going to lead to proxy wars in Africa, where the United States is secretly helping one side and the Soviet Union is secretly helping the other side. And it leads to this huge expansion of American military power. Today, America spends more on its military than the next six countries combined. And that is all traced back to this NSC 68, where it's decided basically that the United States will become the policeman of the world and will stop communism now, no matter what. And NSC 68, this idea of stopping communism, no matter what, is going to dictate American foreign policy all the way up until the 1980s. While all of that's going on, there's a civil war in China. In China, the Nationalist Party is going to be fighting the Communist Party. And this civil war actually begins in 1927 when Mao Zedong starts this communist uprising in the peasants. They're fighting against a guy named Chiang Kai-shek, who is the leader of the Nationalists. During World War II, the two sides temporarily unite to fight the Japanese. But almost as soon as the war, meaning World War II, is over, the Civil War begins again. And World War II is a time where Mao Zedong is able to get even more support. And when the war resumes, Mao Zedong controls a quarter of the population of China. Now, Chiang Kai-shek is still supported by the US government. The US government's going to pour money into Chiang Kai-shek's government and his military, but Mao Zedong is going to win. In 1949, the communists defeat the nationalists. The nationalists are forced to retreat to Taiwan, and the nationalist government sets up a de facto country. Even today, in 2021, Taiwan is officially not a country. Taiwan is in this gray area where it operates as a country and it claims to be the true government of China, while the Chinese Communist Party claims that Taiwan is a renegade province that should be reunited with mainland. The United States does not recognize the communist government until the 1970s when Richard Nixon goes to communist China for the first time. There's also in here a government policy that you should know, and that's this idea of massive deterrence as well as flexible response. Massive deterrence is a creation of Dwight D. Eisenhower, and it goes very closely with mutually assured destruction. For Dwight D. Eisenhower, nuclear weapons were a first-line defense. He's perfectly okay with using nuclear weapons. Dwight D. Eisenhower was the primary general of the U.S. forces in World War II. He's an old military hand, and he says overwhelming force, absolute destruction is the best way to defeat your enemies. When John F. Kennedy becomes president after Dwight D. Eisenhower, he is going to look at the situation. He comes up with a different idea. JFK is going to be okay using conventional military, no nuclear weapons. He is going to rely on this quick deployment of troops to stop communism. So when the Communist Party and the non-communist parties in Vietnam start to fight, JFK in 1961 very quickly sends in forces to try and stop the communist revolution from growing. We also have a very big event happening in Cuba. Before Fidel Castro, there was a dictator named Fulgencio Batista. Fulgencio Batista was absolutely hated by the Cuban people. He was a dictator in the truest sense of the word, but the United States supported him because he was not communist. Batista takes over the government in 1952 through a military coup. He names himself the leader, and everybody has a bad taste in their mouth. By 1959, Fidel Castro is going to overthrow Fulgencio Batista. And Fidel Castro is going to be supported by the Soviet Union primarily because the United States turned him down. Fidel Castro actually tried to get assistance from the United States. Fidel Castro, he appears on the Ed Sullivan Show, which was like the 1950s and 1960s version of the Tonight Show or The Late Show with Stephen Colbert. It was a big deal to appear on the Ed Sullivan Show. In fact, the Ed Sullivan Show is where the Beatles made their American debut. So Castro was actually popular in the United States. In 1958, Castro meets with the then Vice President Richard Nixon. And Castro asks for help from the United States government, says, "Hey, here's my plan. I want to nationalize industry. I want to pay the businesses who we take over." And Nixon says, "That sounds a lot like communism. Maybe we can't help you." And at that point, Castro is going to turn to the Soviet Union, and the Soviet Union is going to welcome them in as a new partner. Well, between 1959 and 1961, the United States is trying to find a way to undo this communist revolution. And President Dwight D. Eisenhower, along with the CIA, are going to create this secret plan to invade Cuba. When JFK comes to office in 1961, he inherits his plan to invade Cuba. It's supposed to use these anti-Castro Cubans, and it's basically, it doesn't look good on paper. JFK wants to call it off, but the CIA and the mafia, along with Cuban exiles, are going to convince JFK to do it. So hundreds of these trained soldiers are going to be shipped to the southern coast of Cuba. They land on a beach located in the Bay of Pigs. And this was a very poorly kept secret. Castro and his armies were on the beach waiting for this invasion. Complete giant failure. Kennedy is forced to go on TV and admit this failure. And Kennedy, even though it wasn't his plan originally, he went along with it. And JFK accepts blame for the failure, but he does not apologize because he truly believes that carrying out this invasion was the right thing for democracy. Fast forward to a year later, and in October of 1962, a U-2 spy plane is going to fly over the Cuban island taking pictures, and it's discovered that a missile base was being built on the tip of Cuba. Now, Cuba is only about 90 to 100 miles away from South Florida, so this was a real issue because these missiles were most likely going to be nuclear. Excuse me, nuclear missiles. Kennedy goes on air on national TV and he demands that these missiles be removed. And Kennedy says, "If these missiles aren't removed, then we'll remove them for you." A blockade is done of the island. Now, in a episode of Brinkmanship, the Soviet Premier Nikita Khrushchev, he readies the missiles for launch, trying to get the United States to back down. And in 1962, it really looks like nuclear war is going to happen. But at the last minute, both sides back down and agree to talk. John F. Kennedy and Nikita Khrushchev are going to make an agreement. Number one, there's going to be a hotline phone or phone hotline put in the Soviet Union's capital, known as the Kremlin, and in the United States White House, where both sides can just pick up the phone and talk whenever they need to. Also, Cuba will have the missiles removed by the Soviet Union, in exchange for the United States removing their missiles from the country of Turkey. Now, a significant point of that is the United States did not know that the Soviet Union was aware that those missiles had secretly been put into Turkey. Because both sides came so close to nuclear weapons, future negotiations are agreed to, and eventually there will be weapons reduction agreements made, and that is known as detente, or this decrease of hostilities. All right, let me pull over our work for this week. So you can see here, 30th of March, Chapter 25, Cold War. And you see there are four things due. There's the Chapter 25 discussion, and there's the Chapter 25 quiz. There's reflection paper number 3, which can be any of the readings from the Great Depression, the World War II lesson, or this lesson, the Cold War. And then there's the museum review also. First thing, I changed the due date. It was originally due on the 5th, but I got to thinking about it, and if we're not having class on the spring break week, why don't I just give you that week to work too? So for this week and this week only, you have 2 weeks to do your work, not just one. That should help a little bit with having to do the extra work. The other thing is the reflection paper. I just want to remind you, 1.5 pages or so double spaced. Your first paragraph will be just a quick summary of the article. Maybe you do the Dutch van Kirk dropping the bomb article. Theodore van Kirk, or Dutch van Kirk, uses this article to explain the reasoning for the dropping of the atomic bomb and his personal thoughts on it. And then from there, the rest of the reflection paper could be you talking about how you agree with what was done, how you disagree with what was done, whether you agree with Van Kirk's opinion, whether you disagree with it, etc., etc. So reflection paper, nothing new. Museum review, on the other hand, I haven't talked much about this. So let me go to that real quick and show you. Museum review, students are expected to visit one of the listed virtual museums or watch one of the listed historical movies located within the museum review folder. Your first page should include your thoughts and opinions of the museum or movie, similar to a reflection paper. The remainder should be a historical critique of the museum or movie. And I give some questions for you to consider, but you are in no way limited to those questions, nor are you obligated to answer them. Those questions are just for example, and you can use them if you'd like, or you can come up with your own questions to answer. This museum review should be about 3 pages, double the length of a reflection paper. For your first half, do just a regular reflection paper. Let's say you watch one of these movies. You want to give your idea. Do you like it? Do you dislike the movie? Or maybe you look at one of these websites. Did you like the website? Did you hate the website? Whatever your opinion might be. So the first half of your museum review is a reflection paper. The second half of your museum review is a historical critique. So maybe you watch the movie Lincoln. You want to explore, is it realistic? Is it historically accurate? Or is it complete Hollywood? Or maybe you look at the National Women's History Museum website. Do the exhibits have explanation? Do you understand what you're looking at? Does the order of the websites make sense? Is there something that they can improve on their website? So that's what we're looking for on a museum review. It's half reflection paper, half historical critique. Let me also say that if this was a non-pandemic semester, if COVID-19 wasn't out there, instead of watching a movie or instead of watching or looking at a website, I would actually have you going to a museum in person. Now I say that because if any of you feel safe enough to go to a museum, I do have a list of those I can give you. That's optional. Going to the museum is optional. The museum review itself is required. Now I'm only requiring you to do one of these virtual museums or to watch one of these historical films, but there is an option if you actually want to go to a museum, you can do that. If you're interested in visiting a museum in person, send me an email and I will reply to your email with my list of physical museums you can go to. But once again, going to a museum is optional, but you must at least look at one of these virtual museums or watch one of these films. If there are any questions at all about the museum review, send me an email. I don't mind answering questions at all. In fact, it gives me something to do. But I think this is probably the longest video of the semester, and if you're still listening right now, I appreciate your time very much. Until next time, we'll see you around. Bye-bye.